question number 11, the following are the components of expenditure for an economy. Now we know that GDP is C plus I plus G plus NX, GDP at MP. So let's add these components. Consumption is 150, investment is 50, government expenses is also 50, and net exports is export minus import. So this is 200, 250, 250 minus 20, which is 230. So GDP at MP is 230. Now we know GNP is 200, and we also know how to go from GDP to GNP. So we basically have to add net factor income from abroad, and then we would arrive at GNP, which is equal to 200. So that means NFIA was minus 30, because GDP is 230. So NFI would be minus 30, getting us to GNP, which is 200. So net factor payments from abroad are minus 30. So this will be minus 30. Save and next. Question number 12, if the demand for money is this, where P is 200, Y is 2000, and R is 0.1, the velocity of money is. So we know that the formula for velocity is MV is equal to PY. Now we have Y, we have P, we need to find M. So M is money demand, which will be equal to money supply at equilibrium. So let's find out what money demand is. So money demand is 1000 plus 0.2y minus 1000r. Let's put in the value. So this is equal to 1000 plus 0.2y is given to us as 2000, and r is given to us as 0.1. Okay, and this is 1000. Okay, so this is going to be equal to 1000 plus 0.2 of 2000 is going to be 400, and 0.1 of 1000 is going to be 100. So this is going to be equal to 1300. Now let's go to the formula. MV is equal to PY. So this is M. Okay, so this is the M of MV. So if M is 1300, V is what we need to calculate. And price is given as 200, and Y is given as 2000. So V is equal to 200 into 2000 upon 1300. So this will be equal to 4000 over 13, which will be equal to 307.69. So we are going to again put down our answer on the notepad. So this is going to be 307.69, and we're going to save our answer. Question number 13. So the IS equation is Y is equal to 100 plus 1 minus TT is 10%. So 1 minus 0.1, which is equal to 0.9y, then plus 300 minus 0.1r plus g. And this is the IS equation. So we can totally differentiate this. You get dy is equal to 0.9dy minus 0.1dr plus dg. Now let's look at the LM equation. So money supply is equal to money demand. So money supply is equal to 1000 is equal to 500 plus 0.3y minus 0.3r. So totally differentiating this again, 0 is equal to 0.3dy minus 0.3dr. So that means dy is equal to dr. So putting 2 in 1. So then we get dy is equal to 0.9 dy minus 0.1 dy, because dyr is replaced by dr plus dg. So that is going to be 0.8. And you subtract that here, this is going to be 0.2 dy is equal to dg. So dy over dg is going to be 1 by 0.2, which is equal to 5. So the expenditure multiplier is 5, and we need to input this. So 5 is the answer, and save next. Question number 14. So nominal interest rate is 4%, and the interest income is taxed. So it will be the nominal income, nominal interest, which is taxed. So tax rate is 25% or 1/4. So post tax nominal interest rate is 4% minus 25%, so which is going to be equal to 3%. So post tax nominal interest rate is 3%. Now real interest rate is going to be equal to nominal interest rate post tax minus the expected inflation. So this is going to be 3% minus expected inflation is 1%. So the thing which is asked us, that what is the after tax real rate of interest, that is going to be 2%. And again, we'll have to input the answer of 2%. So 2 here, and then please save your answer.
IIT JAM 2021 mock. Question number 15, NAD section. Let P be the proportion of people infected by a virus in the population. P had be the sample proportion of people who tested positive in an independently drawn random sample of size N. The minimum value of N such that 95% confidence interval, where the critical value is 1.96, is this. Okay, so I know that this margin of error, that's 0.049, this 0.049 is basically 1.96 multiplied by the standard error of this proportion. Now the standard error of the proportion is basically P into Q, which is 1 minus P by N. Okay, I need to find out the minimum value of N. For that, I will have to take the maximum value of P into 1 minus P. So 0.049 divided by 1.96 will give me 0.025, which is equal to root over maximum value of P into 1 minus P will occur when P is half. Okay, so half goes there, 0.025 half, so it goes there. That means root N is equal to half by 0.025. It's 1 by 40. 40 by 2 is 20. N is equal to 400. So minimum value of N will be 400. I need at least 400 N in order to ensure that the confidence interval is this. Okay.
Question number 16. In an examination, there are 10 multiple choice questions, each having 5 options, and only one option is correct. That means the probability of getting the right option, if marked randomly, is 1 by 5. The kth question carries k marks, where k is 1 to 10. So the value of the question is also not constant. The first question is worth 1 mark, the second question is worth 2 marks, and so on. So the last question is actually worth 10 marks. The student attempts all questions making a random guess. So the expected marks for the student is going to be, so 1 by 5 out of 1, and then 1 by 5 out of 2, and then 1 by 5 out of 3, so on. And this goes for 1 by 5 till 1 by 5 out of 10. So taking 1 by 5 common, that's 1 plus 2 plus 3 up till 10. And we can use the formula for n into n plus 1 by 2. Here n is 10, so 1 by 5 into 10 into 11 by 2, so this is 5, 5 cancel, so 11. So the expected mark of the student is 11. And we need to input our answer and save and next.
Question number 17, NAT section. You take a loan of 1000 at time period t is equal to 0. So 1000 at time period t is equal to 0. Since you have taken the loan, that's why I've written it as minus 1000. Okay. Then you are repaying it in 12 equal installments of 100 each, starting at time period 1, ending at time period 12. So 1, 2 up to 12, I am paying 100, 100, 100, 100. Okay. Assume that t is measured in months. So this is the month. The average annual interest rate in percent that you are paying is. So let's try to see this. So what do we see? We see that if I need to repay 100, 100, 100, 100 for 12 months for this amount of 1000. So what I do is basically I find out the present discounted value of each of these installments. So the first 100 will be discounted by R, 1 plus R, second 1 plus R square, dot, 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 100 by 1 plus R to the power 12. This R is basically the interest rate per month. This is the interest rate per month, not per annum. So in order to find out the answer, I'll have to multiply R by 12. That will give me the answer of the question. So then we try to see what will I get. 1 plus 1 by 1 plus R plus dot 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 1 by 1 plus R to the power 11. There are 12 terms. So we will apply that. A into 1 minus R to the power N by 1 minus common ratio. So this cancels out. This will give us only R. So this will be 100 by R into 1 minus 1 by 1 plus R to the power 12. This has to be equal to 1000. Okay. So we need to find out the value of R from this. So once you solve this, you'll be getting R is equal to 0.029, approximately this. Therefore, 12R is equal to, just multiply this by 12, 0.3507. So the interest rate that you're paying in percent will be 35.07%. This will be by interest rate per annum. See, the total amount that you're paying is 100 multiplied by 12. So you're actually paying 1,200 on your entire loan of 1,000. And that too in a year. So you're essentially paying 200 as interest. 200 is the interest payment on 1,000. Correct? And you are paying 1 month at a time. It's not that after a year you're paying 1,200. No, you're paying 100 every month. So obviously the interest rate has to be definitely higher than at least 20%. Okay, and you calculate it, it will be 35.07%. Question number 18. NAT, suppose a consumer, this is the utility function, the prices is this. So let's find out the initial utility is x1, x2, whole to the power of half. Money income 100, price is 1. So how much an x1 of x1 and x2 is the person consuming? It's half into, so 50 of each. Okay, so what will be the utility achievable? 50 into 50 to the power half, which is 50. So this was the utility enjoyed by the consumer in the initial equilibrium. Assume that the price of good one has now increased to 2. Okay, so let's take the money income as say M bar. Price of good 1 has increased to 2. So this becomes my budget line. And the utility is the same. X1, X2 to the power half. Okay, additional money that should be given to the consumer to make him as well off okay. So from this new, I get my x1 is 1 by 2 into m bar by 2. So this is basically m bar by 4. X2 value will be 1 by 2. I'm basically using the shortcut for Cobb-Douglas. So this is m bar by 2. So the utility enjoyed is basically m bar square by 8 whole to the power half. This is m bar by 2 root 2. This is equal to, this is the utility, and this has to be equal to the utility earlier. So m bar is basically 100 root 2. The additional money that should be given to the consumer to make him as well off as he was previously. So the money income required by the consumer in order to make him as well off as he was earlier is 100 root 2 at the new prices. So the additional money will be 100 root 2 minus the income earlier. 100 root 2 minus 100. Find out the value of this. That will be your answer. So let's use the calculator, find out the value. So this is 41.42. Okay. Question number 19, NAT. So the monopolist is facing this kind of a demand function. So if I multiply by P, if I want to find out root over P is equal to 100 by Q, this is what I'll get. So P is equal to 10,000 by Q square, or P into Q is equal to 10,000 by Q. That is, total revenue is equal to 10,000 by Q. Okay. So what can be said about the profit function? Total revenue minus total cost. Total cost is 10 is the marginal cost, and 10 is the per unit tax imposed of the government. So 10 plus 10, 20 Q. Right? The hint is that look at the total revenue. It's 10,000 by Q. That is, as my Q is increasing, my total revenue is falling. As my Q is increasing, my total revenue is falling. So how much should I produce? I should produce when my Q is going to zero. I should produce a negligible or a fraction quantity such that my Q is going to zero. And my cost will also go to zero. Correct? Because as I produce more and more, like for example, Q is equal to 1, this is basically 10,000 minus 20. If my Q is equal to 2, this will be 10,000 by 2, which is 5,000 minus 40. Can you see that Q is equal to 1, my profit is 9880. With Q is equal to 2, my profit is only 4960. It's almost half to what it was when my Q is equal to 1. And further, if my Q is equal to half, my profit will be even higher. My profit will be even higher. Right? So my quantity is going to zero in this kind of a scenario. The total tax revenue earned by the government is round off to two decimal places. It is going to zero. Quantity is going to zero. Therefore, the tax revenue is also going to zero. The best answer would be zero. Okay. NAT question number 20. Let capital M and small m be respectively the maximum and the minimum values of the function. So this is my fx. Let's write my fx in this way, x plus 2 minus 3. 1 minus 3 by x plus 2. Now, as you can see, my derivative will be 3 by x plus 2 square, which is positive. That is, my f is increasing as my x is increasing. My f is increasing as my x is increasing. Therefore, minimum value will occur at minus 1. Just put minus 1 here. So 1 minus 3 minus 1 plus 2 minus 2. This is my minimum value. And my maximum value will occur at my highest value, which is 4, which is 1 minus 3 by 4 plus 2. 6, so 1 minus half, which is half. So this is my minimum value, minus 2 maximum value is half. M is the maximum plus K into minimum value is equal to 0. So half is equal to 2K, or in other words, K is equal to 1 by 4. Round off to 2 decimal places, what is the value of K? 0.25. That's the answer.